Hello, you are viewing this video because you've been scheduled for knee arthroscopy. I am sure you have many questions about your procedure. Hopefully this video will answer most, if not all, of your questions. If you have further questions, I'll be happy to answer them at your next follow-up. Please follow along with the presentation booklet that was provided. I will discuss the procedure and attendant risks. I will cover the postoperative care you will receive and give you an idea of what you should expect during your postoperative course. Let's get started. Meniscal tears, ligament, and cartilage damage occur with knee injury. Meniscal tears result from the femur and tibia trapping the meniscus in between them during twisting motions. The ligament injuries and/or meniscal tears cause swelling and pain in the knee. Meniscal tears can also cause locking, which means the knee is stuck and will not bend or straighten. Locking usually means the meniscus tissue is displaced and caught between the femur and tibia. Patients describe shaking or gently twisting the knee, feeling a pop or click, and then having return of motion. Cartilage damage is a difficult problem with only limited ability to treat. These are the main problems usually treated with knee arthroscopy. Superficially, the knee joint is surrounded by the quadriceps, muscles, and tendon above, and the patellar tendon below. The knee joint itself consists of the end of the thigh bone or femur, the top of the leg bone or tibia, and the back of the kneecap or patella. These bones are all covered with articular cartilage, which provides the smooth surface for range of motion. The tibia also is covered with the meniscus, which acts as a shock absorber. The knee joint is stabilized by multiple ligaments, two on the inside called cruciate ligaments, and two on the outside called collateral ligaments. Knee arthroscopy, also known as a knee scope, is an outpatient procedure done through three small incisions. Through the small incisions, I am able to insert a camera into the joint to directly see the structures of the knee joint. The camera is fixed inside a larger tube. Water flows around the camera inside the outer tube to fill up the knee joint. The fluid is held inside the capsule, resulting in increased pressure, which serves to decrease bleeding and to separate the knee structures for visualization. The first part of the knee scope is the diagnostic portion. During this portion of the arthroscopy, the entire visible portion of the knee joint is inspected and then probed. The preoperative diagnosis is confirmed and other injuries can be identified. For meniscal tears, repair is preferable, but only applicable in younger patients with adequate blood supply to the injured tissue. The older we get, the less blood supply is present in the meniscal tissues. Therefore, more often than not, the meniscal tear is removed, leaving a stable meniscal remnant. Loose cartilage and bone fragments can also be removed, allowing smoother surfaces and return to more normal range of motion. Generalized cartilage damage due to arthritis is not readily treated. Isolated discrete cartilage injuries can sometimes be treated with techniques involving marrow stimulation, known as microfracture. Another alternative in specific circumstances involves transplanting a good area of cartilage with its underlying bone into the area of damaged cartilage. After surgery, there is usually no restriction in motion or weight bearing. Initially, ice, compression, and crutch use is very important. You must keep the incisions clean and dry for 5 days. After the first 5 days, it is okay to shower without covering the incisions. I ask you to be an indoor person for 5 days to severely restrict activity. I do want you to stand and walk around inside your house every 60 to 90 minutes in order to avoid blood clots. But otherwise, elevate, ice, and compress so that the knee inflammation from surgery is minimized. After the first 5 days and before your first follow-up appointment, avoid long periods of standing and walking. I expect return to unrestricted activity within 6 weeks. Cartilage treatments will result in limitation in weight bearing all the way out to 6 weeks sometimes. This is rare, but could be the case. After knee arthroscopy, knee pain should be relatively minimal. Narcotics are not normally required. Tylenol and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, such as ibuprofen and Aleve, generally suffice. Walking usually normalizes in 5 to 7 days. Follow-up appointments are scheduled for 7 to 10 days and 6 weeks after surgery. Dressings stay on for 48 hours and then is removed. The incision can be cleaned one time only with tap water or a small amount of hydrogen peroxide. Also, one time only, apply a very small amount of an antibiotic ointment to the incisions. With dressing removal, apply Band-Aids, which can be changed daily and completely removed after 5 days if desired. Sometimes patients feel better covering the suture sites to avoid contact with clothes. As mentioned, indoor activities for 5 days and then slight increase activity out to 2 weeks. From 2 to 6 weeks, you must avoid impact or twisting activities. There will be no restrictions after 6 weeks. The risks associated with arthroscopy are blood clot, bleeding, and infection. These complications are very rare, but usually require further surgery and antibiotic treatment. The best way to treat complications is to avoid them. Knee arthroscopy is a relatively short outpatient surgery with minimal risk. Knee arthroscopy is beneficial for the appropriate diagnoses and should not worsen knee pain. It is important to limit activity as directed, no matter how good the knee feels, to avoid rebound pain and swelling, which will result in a much longer recovery. Compliance to post-op instructions is the way to give you the best chance of decreased pain and return to a higher level of function. It can get you back to doing the activities that you love.